Good evening. Well, it's good evening where I am, but it's not, it's daytime where my special guests are. My name is Mia Bays and I run Bird's Eye View, and we're the UK's leading gender equality and film organisation. We are cultural activists and we established ourselves as a charity in 2003, originally as a film festival, showing films by women from around the world. And then in 2017, we began to work year round because 10 days a year was not enough. This is a big mission, as I'm sure you all know, and we call it Reclaim the Frame. So we're delighted to be able to invest in the releases of films and champion films such as Mouthpiece. And I'm delighted to share the screen with the filmmakers tonight, who I will introduce shortly. I am also a film producer, and I've produced films that won an Oscar and been nominated for several BAFTAs, and also work as a release strategist. So I will also thematically relevant to this film, talk with sort of a dual representation and a double perspective, both as a filmmaker and as a champion of the film. So Mouthpieces, hopefully you will have seen it. If you haven't, it's an incredibly powerful, funny, unique and highly original look into the conflicted psyche of a fiercely independent millennial woman, played by two actresses simultaneously, Norah Sadava and Amy Nostbakken, who you see here, who also wrote the piece with Patricia Rozema, who also directed, who you also see here. And they play Cassandra, the character who navigates the sudden loss of her mother. And I would like to welcome director Patricia Rozema, who achieved prominence with her first feature film, I've Heard the Mermaid Singing, 1987, which I completely fell in love with at the beginning of my career. So it's such a delight to welcome you, Patricia. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Mia.
Patricia's other features include Into the Forest, Mansfield Park. She wrote the Grey Gardens script, not the documentary, but the fiction adaptation. And TV work includes directing episodes of In Treatment and Anne with an E, and a new upcoming Netflix series, which I just discovered today, which sounds fabulous, called Sex/Life. And Mouthpiece is also produced by Patricia through her company Crucial Things, and first generation films, Christina Piovazan and Jennifer Shin. Welcome, Patricia.
Thank you very much.
And Amy Nostbakken plays poor Cassandra, just so you know. You can't tell that sitting down, but she's tall Cassandra and is co-screenwriter.
She's actually short Cassandra.
Short Cassandra, sorry, that's bad note.
Not true.
And co-screenwriter and composer. And Amy is an award-winning director, playwright, performer, composer, and is co-artistic director of the theatre company, quote-unquote, Collective in Toronto. And Amy has created and composed numerous productions internationally, including Mouthpiece, which continues to tour the globe, which hopefully we will talk about. And your recent projects include, quote-unquote, Six Woman Show, Now You See Her. So welcome, Amy. And last but not least, Norah Sadav, who also plays Cassandra and also co-wrote the film and the play on which it's based, and is an award-winning performer, director and playwright, and is co-artistic director of quote-unquote Collective, and created and performed in numerous productions internationally, including Mouthpiece and recent projects, Now You See Her. Welcome to all of you. It's so lovely to be with you on this special day, which is a rather momentous day because more women than ever, for female creatives, have been nominated for Oscars, more historically than ever in the 70 plus year history of the Oscars. So thank you to, it's lovely to be here with you on this day. So welcome. I'm going to stop talking and just let you say hello.
Yeah, it's exciting to see women getting their due. It's long been overlooked, and you know, women were seen as a kind of a little niche interest, but not really the main addressing the main themes or issues of international cinema, and which is basically the arc of male white, you know, triumph over whatever, for everything. So, you know, women's stories have been, you know, of interest, but not considered the main course. So it's really exciting for me, who's been at it for a little while, to see the shift, to see, you know, I was a bit of an exception to the rule in that I got to have a career and I was invited and won some awards, but I really feel the difference now. I feel the difference when I go into a meeting at a high level, or at a whatever medium level of budget, and I feel the difference. They want you to be good rather than, all right, what's this female womany stuff you got for me now? You know, like, so it's an exciting moment, and I think we're just beginning. I really do. I think there's a paradigm shift happening.
A woman to that, Patricia. And Norah and Amy, this is your first film. So, I mean, maybe let's start there, actually. So theatre is your world. What was the transition like?
I mean, major. Norah and I had never had any aspirations to be in film or work in film in any way. We just never crossed our minds. And so when Patricia saw the play and we went out for a coffee with her to meet her, and she suggested that, or she offered, I want to throw my hat in the ring to make a film out of this. We were just like, all right, sure, why not? You got nothing to lose. And then when we started working together, it became such a real thing, and it was such a joy to work on it at every stage. And we just kept saying yes and more and what else. And it was just it was so imaginative and creative and, as I said, fun. So very different than creating a play, the play over 3 years, devising in basements and bedrooms and bashing your head against the wall going, what the hell are we making? And is this going to be any good? And also at the time, I mean, we began creating the play in 2013. And so we were terrified when we premiered the play in 2015 for all of the truths we were admitting about ourselves that we had never heard uttered out loud before. But by the time the film premiered, and then again now, the UK premiere, the landscape looks and sounds totally different.
Can I just ask, I don't know the answer, but which truths were you nervous of sharing at that early time?
For me, it was it's specific. It's the idea of being naked in my bathroom, looking at myself in the mirror and pretending that there are men inside my eyeballs with cameras looking at my own body. This confession of, like, it's embarrassing and it's true, and it's not me as a child, it's me as an adult, and walking down the street and imagining there are men looking at me, so imagining myself through their eyes, not my own. This confession to me was, because outwardly I was a liberated, tough, extremely tough, hard-shelled chick. So admitting that I was not any of those things.
But there was a performative element to that.
It took like the process of Amy and I writing the play was very layered, and it took us a lot of time because we would do writing exercises such as write the thing you're the most ashamed of. That's it. 20 minutes later, we have to read them out loud to each other. And we didn't know each other that well. We met making the play. And we would read them out loud and hear each other and say, I hear you and I feel the same way. You're still hiding something. Go back and reveal the next layer of truth. There's a bit of bullshit there still. And so that kind of exercise of, like, you know, first admitting to yourself, then admitting to your collaborator, and then standing in a bathing suit on stage with nothing to hide behind and saying them to an audience of 200 people. It was kind of layers of that fear and dealing with shame and dealing with how to overcome it but it was so empowering that even while it was happening, it felt like it was transforming us and the air around us.
I read that you said actually that you had multiple epiphanies whilst writing the material, and particularly awakenings as feminists. So can you just maybe unpack that a little bit, because I want to come back to the double consciousness and bring Patricia in, because I just think the double consciousness is just fascinating on so many levels.
Well, we started writing the play in 2013, and we were explicitly saying to each other, if we call this a feminist play, no one will come. And it was pre-hashtag feminism. And we both had lived really independent lives, and lives where we didn't want to admit that we needed to, that it was harder. You know, it was like, you just have to work twice as hard. That was the attitude. And then as we were writing the play, we started, through this writing process, we started uncovering all this shit that was ugly and shameful and scary. And we realized there was like a series of events that happened along the way that kind of set off light bulbs. And there was a famous email between Amy and I that was like the manifesto of, oh no, it is a feminist play, and we have to call it that, and we have to insist on that being the main event. And this play has to be about the fact that we are realizing this, which is quite meta, but it was kind of the ball started rolling then. Then the writing started to get easy because we were just feeling so much and we had somewhere to put it.
And if I remember what you told me, it started out as female friendships and then evolved into two sides of one person.
Yeah, the initial idea was about female relationships, so mother, daughter, sister, lover, friend. And so we were examining the different kind of relationships. And then we reckoned if we're going to examine female relationship, we should examine first what it is to be a woman. And to research that, we should ask our own selves what that feels like. And then when we had this epiphany, we realized we needed at least two women to describe what it feels like inside our heads. So that shift was, we had the idea and then it was obvious. And then it was like, of course we need to do that, at least two.
So I saw that play. My daughter was interning at the theater that was producing it and in one of its iterations. And I kind of went dutifully because I was trying to support my daughter and I really kind of, whatever. My mind was blown. Right from the beginning, where you sit in the dark with these extraordinary harmonies, this beautiful music, and in the pitch dark for like a dangerously long time, like, you know, if you just think of screening people's to patients or something, but it kind of takes you over and then you're seduced into this kind of trusting place. And then these two women come out and they are funny and they're irreverent and they're like, my mom croaked kind of talk, and like, and then they slip into perfect synchronized, you know, unison on very naturalistic, very casual gestures, and then they're at odds with each other, and then they're making fun of other people's attempts at comforting them about their mother, and then it's just the two of them in white bathing suits on a, you know, black stage with a bathtub. And I had no idea how. I had no idea how, but for some reason I am of the kind of mind where I think, this is lightning. This is light. Catch it. Do something here. Like the voice, this intelligence, the emotional honesty, bring this to life in a film. And I immediately thought, two people playing one on screen. Because I lived my whole life feeling like two people. And one always feeling at odds with myself, and I even, it seems my conversational style is to counter the other person in a way of honing a point. And I just feel like that's a central mode of human exploration, is, you know, thesis, antithesis, and yin and yang, and back and forth, like it's basic to how we refine our thoughts and elevate our thoughts, I think. So I was very excited by the, like, somebody who had externalized something that was very deeply felt by me, and then also about the loss of a parent, about death. I thought, this doesn't come along very often, something so eternal and yet so formally inventive. So I just knew, and I didn't even know how, and I kept thinking, screen direction, where will the other person that's interacting with them look? And I suddenly got into technical problems. But then I just invited them up to my, have a little cabin by a lake, and we didn't know each other at all. It was just supremely awkward at first. And just when we dove in, and then they started to make me laugh, and I started making them, and it was just fine. And then we just started talking. At first we thought TV thing, and then that, I don't know, that never really flew. And then we started just hashing, and then it was an hour long, and I am a mother. I have two children, 25 and 17 now. And I my mother died at the age of these characters, at the 30. So I felt like I had something authentic to offer, that I wasn't just going to be stealing their, you know, their beautifulness, but that I could actually contribute something. It's really important to me when I make something, like, it's right that it's me doing it, you know, that it's not just, hey, I'd love that, but I actually have something to give. So I felt like I might have something to give, and they seemed to think so too. So off we went.
Patricia, didn't you say that when you saw it post making the movie, you had like retroactive anxiety?
I looked at it, we shot it, and I was the whole time, I'm not prone to panic attacks or anything like that, but it was an aesthetic panic attack. I was like, how did I think this could make a movie? Like, it was a leap of faith that in hindsight, I was surprised that anyone would dare to myself. I don't know. I go with the feeling. I'm not a strategic career planning kind of filmmaker. I just wait to fall in love, and I fell in love, and off we went. We had just a name drop of for a minute, but we had a lovely little help, which was that Alex Hedison and Jodie Foster were in town, and I had just had coffee with Alex, and she was asking, you know, what should we do in Toronto? And I said, well, here's something you're never going to see anywhere else. It's like a brand new voice in theater and in feminist thought too. And so I sort of snuck them in the back of the theater through some friends, and they watched it and they loved it. And they went backstage to Amy and Norah, who were like, wait, aren't you like a movie star? And then they, out of the goodness of their hearts, funded a moving the play to LA just to show their friends. No benefit to themselves, just sharing art. So that was and they didn't, you know, they weren't involved in the movie, but they were really helpful. But so we had a celebrity blessing that helped us raise the money, and I just willed this into being. I pushed it forward, and I called up funding agencies and said, this is what you are for. And I called up people of means who had, supported the arts before and said, come on, like, you know, this is what it's about. Do you believe in this? Okay, so contribute. And then they followed each other. And then suddenly we were on we were shooting very quickly after.
And can you talk, Amy and Norah, a bit about the kind of top? I mean, it's set over a very specific period of time, and it's set in Toronto. I don't know how much you're also saying about Toronto or Canada. It would be really interesting to kind of hear, because, you know, whether you think the work sits within a kind of Canadian tradition of feminism. But I mean, there's a wonderful montage where you have Alice Munro and you have Margaret Atwood novels, and you have an album by Joni Mitchell. So you sort of somewhat feel like you're situating the film in that framework. But it would be nice to listen to you talk a bit more about the time and place.
Well, of the play, we just write what we know, so it's much easier to go from a, you know, utterly personal place. But interesting, you know, we toured the show for 4 years internationally and wondered if it would translate, and of course it did. The audiences reacted in the same way, whether we in Canada or the States or Europe. So I believe there's something universal, and it's different audience members react off of different aspects, whether it's the grief or the feminist awakening or the duality. A lot of men react to the duality or even just the technicality of the synchronicity. But the film, I don't know, Patricia, do you want to talk about Toronto in the
when
film?
When we were shooting it, I said, okay, this is an aggressively Canadian film production, which is a bit of a contradiction in terms, but I just told the designers and props and everybody, I said, if it's something you could only find in Toronto, put it in. So I accentuated streetcars and the sand towers in there, and just everything that we could, the Eaton Center, the stupid puppet coats, and there's nobody else in the world knows, but everybody in Toronto has PTSD about getting their bicycle tire stuck in the streetcar tracks. That is like a source of great trauma. I'm overstating the case, but surprisingly, so when people react to it, Canadians see all that and feel affirmed, and other people don't seem to see it and seem to feel affirmed, you know, seem to feel seen anyway. So it's a real lesson in just, you know, diving into place. And I can remember my father always used to say, you know, any square inch of the planet is interesting if you look at it with enough love and detail and care. So that's what we decided to do. So it's full of little Canadian references. But yeah, I feel like I think that doing that, no matter where you're from in the world, doing that gives the rest of the world a sense of comfort somehow, that you're not hiding. Canada has a whole slew of films where we kind of like, okay, well, let the Americans think that this is Cincinnati or something, and we're not going to tell them. And I feel like, you know, that hiding of yourself permeates the movie in other ways and creates a barrier between you and the audience, maybe.
I think, interestingly, just quickly before we move on, there's been an interesting thing happen with the play, which is that we performed it for 4 years in Canada, in the States, in the UK. And now we've had a huge amount of requests for translation, particularly in countries that have a less progressive government in regards to gender equality. So it's most recently been translated in Turkish and Romanian, where they still need a lot of fighting like for the basics. And I think that it's just interesting to watch the trickle of time, that it's remaining extremely relevant in different spaces in the world, and how people gravitate towards it when it feels like this is the right time for this piece of art now. And I think the film is kind of doing the same. Like, we released this a couple of years ago where we're from, and it's having a bit of its own life when people need it.
That's a really wonderful observation, and I think also, you know, film used to be very, very kind of drawn by everything, all about the new, and films had a very short shelf life, and particularly the past year, it feels like something's changed, and so it's really wonderful to hear that not just, that the play's finding other relevance, and maybe it's going to be a tool for feminism. What a wonderful thing, and perhaps the film is too. I mean, how does that feel Patricia, from your perspective, you're a bit of an old hand, and like, do you think film can change the world?
I do. Mm-hmm. I do. I believe that art is how we, one of the ways, but a significant one in how we learn to love and learn to improve our own minds and our own attitudes towards ourselves and towards others. I just read this thing. It's like the most important relationship on screen is the relationship of the protagonist with themselves. I thought that's fascinating because that's applies to this. I really do believe that through story, we externalize what is troubling or, you know, a difficult or a conflict in our lives, and then we bring people in. I mean, it's a commonplace to say it's about empathy, and so I think for men to understand the female experience, I think a film like this can really help. I've had so many men come up and say, I didn't know. I get it now. I get something I didn't know before. Why are you laughing, Amy?
Because it's amazing.
And it's amazing.
What a gift.
Well, thank you. Yeah. But anyway, that's, I do believe, I also have felt like this film has had an unusual unveiling in that, you know, we started, I guess, what, 2018 at TIFF, and then the Toronto Film Festival, and then it was released in Canada and the US, and now here we are in 2021, and I've seen a change in the landscape, and I feel like it's actually great that there's a bit of a delay. I think there's an awareness on the part of male critics that they better take the women seriously now. I feel the difference. I feel the difference. I'm not as sidelined or seen as an interesting also ran, you know? So that has made a difference. And our dream is that other distributors pick it up now and we go off, because it is such a very different kind of film. I think it's going to stay interesting. It's not going to date quickly, right? It's very, such an unusual thing. So that's the dream, because that I know people have emotional, very emotional reactions to it.
Yes,
they're very, very moved. So I believe that this can have can be a tool of change. You know, every little bit helps.
Mm-hmm. I totally concur. Before we bring in our next guest, I actually wanted to talk about one of my, I have many favorite scenes. There's lots of standout scenes. The writing's wonderful, and as is the direction. And so there's lots of indelible markers. But one particularly is when Cassandra is a child and she's not yet split off into two. So I love that you did that, and I want you to talk about that. And she observes her mother's misery and dropping her writer's notebook into a bowl of soup that she's cooked for the kids. And the child absorbs there, as children do, the parent's anxiety. And perhaps in doing so, there's a movement towards understanding and maturity in the child. So I just wanted to, I'd like Norah and Amy, first of all, just talk about sort of the writing of that, and then Patricia, the decisions around not splitting Cassandra off at that point.
We talked a lot about when and how she became divided. Mm-hmm. And again, like the whole process, it felt very intuitive, and we were reflecting on our own lives. Did I feel divided at the age of 5? No. I was in my experience making moves, trying to absorb, trying to do, eating, tasting, dreaming. Was I divided at the age of 9? I don't think so. And it gets to a murky place where I think a lot of people find their own, the journey is different for everyone, right? So we made a decision that the younger daughter, even we see her at the age of about 11, she's still one, she's still a child. And that that just feels true to our experience, that there's a point in whether it's puberty or whether it's going through some sort of development, especially as women and especially related to our bodies and our sexuality and our identity, we get fractured. And we didn't feel the need to write that in the moment, but
we did write it, remember? And then it didn't feel right. We had a scene where she split.
Right.
We were where there was a kind of a, don't show that side of yourself. There was an encouragement from the mother, in fact. And and then it felt way too reductive to just have one little, you know, comment from one person, because it's so much more complex. So we took it out and just thought, no, people will get this. Like, respect the audience.
Well, and in the same way, we've spoken a lot about how people are always trying, and you still see, even we've gotten some reviews the past week, quite a few, that reduce us to a binary. She's the sour-faced one, and she's the nice one. She's the evil
resting
one.
Resting bitch face. She's the angel. That was a review a few days ago.
And that we defiantly declare that's not how our brains work. Our brains work in a myriad of ways where it's always switching and changing, and there's no division of black and white. So the idea of seeing her divide and that there's two versions of her feels way too simple for how we actually feel.
That scene that you're talking about wasn't in the play. And it came about when we were investing ourselves in the mother's experience, because the play was so much more from the daughter's point of view. And then when we decided to expand and make it into a movie, we were, what is it to be, you know, this woman who is underachieved, you know, who has all of the love and the aspiration of any of us, and give so much to the children, and then have the children kind of reject and minimize, and that is devastating. And then to me, one of the saddest things in the world is to see someone give up on their hopes of self-expression. It's like, I can't think of anything more devastating to imagine. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, and then of course, just as a filmmaker, you think, okay, how do I make that? How do I make that visual and fresh and new in a way that I've never seen before? So to destroy the object of all of your notes and your thoughts in something domestic, that and green, mm-hmm. pea soup, that seemed to be the almost, you know, the most graphic way of portraying it. Isn't that a little girl amazing? She just has such an almost impassive face, but it's so soulful with such intent. I really loved working with that girl. Anyway.
Beautiful. Thank you, Patricia. I would now like to welcome into the conversation Dr. Lucy Selman, and we are inviting Lucy into this conversation because we particularly staged this, the date of this, and the day after Mother's Day, particularly because of conversations that I have as someone who's lost their mother. And that's why I love this film so much, because for me, it's a really very complex and very layered excoriation of the messiness of grief. And Lucy has quite a lot of connections to that topic as an academic. So Lucy is a senior research fellow in the School of Population Health Sciences at the University of Bristol, and currently conducting an NIHR career development fellowship, leading the Oscar study, and also principal investigator on a national study on bereavement during the pandemic. So particularly relevant talk now, grief is everywhere, we're all going through it in various ways. And most importantly, in terms of this context, the founding director of the Good Grief Festival. So welcome to you, Lucy. It's wonderful to have you. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me. And can I just say, I've been so enjoying eavesdropping on the conversation so far. Just really fascinating to hear you all talk about the film. So thank you. Yeah.
So Lucy, let's start with, and then we'll bring everyone into this. So Lucy, let's just, apologies, Patricia, we were talking over each other. Lucy, if you could just give us your response to the film, particularly from your perspective in terms of the research work that you do and in relation to the space that you've created with the Good Grief Festival.
Yeah, sure. I think one of my main reflections is just building on this idea of authenticity, which Laura's just been talking about, and Amy as well, that you can see how much work has gone into this film to emphasize and explore authentic experience. And I think that's also reflected in how grief is portrayed in the film. Grief is inherently messy, complicated, it's full of ambivalence, conflict, a whole, you know, host of human emotions, from anger and sadness to you know, release and even maybe joy at some of the memories you might have. And I think the film captured that so well, that the sense that when you lose someone close to you, your life becomes shattered and your experience can feel so confusing for the person, so much so that you might feel in two minds, that ambivalence kind of writ large in your life. And it really made me reflect, actually, and I was asking Patricia and Amy and Norah about this earlier, on one of the kind of main models of grief and bereavement called the dual process model, which configures grief as having these two elements. So on the one hand, loss-oriented behavior and activities, where you're really kind of immersing yourself in the grief. And I know, I think in particular of the scenes of the film where Cassie is kind of almost drowning in the bath, that sense of kind of suffocating and being really lost and immersed in grief and the difficulties around that. And then on the other hand, these other behaviors which are more kind of restoration oriented. And those kind of restoration oriented behaviors are things that kind of let you get on with daily life. So it could be spending time with a friend, watching a movie, laughing, and, you know, doing things in your life which are really about accommodating the loss rather than dwelling in the loss. And I think, you know, I immediately thought of that when I saw this dual character and the sort of conflict and complexity within that character. So it's very interesting to me that actually, you know, that was actually a reflection of, you know, your experiences and your artistic expression, rather than knowing that there is this model kind of out there of grief.
Well, yeah, we didn't know about that, you know, dual process at all. Just, I think we all as people know about the feeling in every situation of, this is serious. Oh my God, this is hilarious. Or this is absurd, or laughing at ourselves while we're in the most, you know, intimate or trying kind of situations. So I think that applies to not only grief, but to everything. Like sex, for instance, like supposedly the moment of the total abandonment, self-consciousness and great intimacy. And then there's the character still watching themselves. Like, how sad is that? But the dual process. Yeah. I mean, I remember my mother died at about the age of this character experience. And I remember we had the kind of container of ashes in the car when we were going to the grave where we were put the ashes in, and my brothers and I just laughing about tipping it over and trying to sweep it up and put it. I mean, we didn't do it, but we were imagining it all. And so I think, humor and it's, I mean, I think probably sometimes people can laugh too much. You know, it's a way of not actually fully experiencing the grief, I think. I may be one of those people.
Well, they do say, yeah. They do say about this theory that the idea of kind of a healthy grief or healthy bereavement is that you oscillate from one to the other. But actually, if you get stuck in one or the other, it can cause problems. So if you're so focused on the kind of loss that you can't accommodate the loss and kind of move through it in some way, you know, you never kind of get over it. But, you know, there can be a way of moving through grief and accommodating it in your life. But then on the other hand, if you get stuck on the other side and you're not looking at the loss and you're just focusing on kind of the restoration activities, distracting yourself and, you know, all of that, then that's also not healthy.
I sometimes question whether you have to get over it. Maybe, yeah, I mean, you're the expert, but I sort of feel like, you know, death is just the most horrifying fact of our lives. And what's surprising is that we're always surprised, whether it's sudden or gradual, everyone's still surprised, even though we all know from age four on that it's going to happen and we're still surprised. But I sometimes wonder whether you need to just, whether, I mean, I think that would be my feeling. I've lost both my parents now and, you know, other people in my lives, in my life and I, my lives. And I think, I don't want to get over it. I just, I want to function, but I want to just actually relish that little area of pain and loss. I just want to keep it. I just,
yeah,
that's the respect. That's respect.
You never get, I don't think you ever get over, I don't think you ever get over a profound loss, a profound bereavement. It's not really about, you know, the idea of getting over it or time healing, you know, it's not, that's not how it goes. You know, grief can completely transform your life and, you know, transform who you are.
That's why I think the film is so important, and films or art can be so important, because it holds the space open for us to move through our own experience whilst also being in someone else's shoes. And I'm really interested, and Norah and Amy, in how, you know, you, how you might have mapped that out as writers, actually, the kind of emotional experience for the viewer.
The when we originally wrote the stage play, the catalyst of the mother dying came very late. We needed a dramatic vehicle to get our girl where she needed to go. We needed her to, you know, have an emotional explosion that caused her to look at herself and look back at the previous generation of women. And what better than death? What's more dramatic than that? And of a mother, just that bond is so specific and can be just so powerful. So, and complex, and complex. So yeah, I mean, for us, it was a dramatic, it was a theatrical dramatic use. And then we wanted to keep the narrative very simple, because the conceit of two women playing one was so massive, and because we really wanted to go deeply internal rather than broadly, you know, having your, have a crazy mission all over the place. So the play version was 24 hours, and then the film, we need a bit more time to get a bit more relationship in there, but it was 48 hours. But so we kept the narrative extremely simple.
I think it's been really interesting for us, as we've experienced our own grief, but we also have performed live a play about grief, or about a woman going through grief for 4 years, and then a film, and being the sounding board for a lot of other people who have that grief brought up has been really interesting to carry and negotiate. And because we are so vulnerable in the performance and in the film, people often come up to us directly after the play and dump their grief in front of us and ask us to see it. And that has been really moving. I was thinking this morning about how we were performing the show in Edinburgh, and we did it every day for 30 days. It's a crazy festival. You get used to people are crying. That's normal. And then one day I came out from backstage after the show, and this young man came up to me and was like, clearly had just been crying the whole time, and told me he was here in Scotland. He was from Montreal. He was here in Scotland because his mother had just died. And they had always said that they would go on a trip to the Highlands together. And then he touched his backpack and said, and she's here with me.
Wow.
And he had the urn in his backpack, and he had no idea what the play was about when he walked in.
Lovely.
And then he was sitting in the audience with his mother at his feet for the whole performance. And the thing I remember him saying the most is he identified a part where Cassandra got really angry at her mother in the play, and she does in the film as well. And he said, it was so relieving to see anger fully expressed, because I'm so angry. Mm. And you don't get space for that. You're not really, it's not a nice thing to show when your mother's just died, that the anger has no place to go. And he just thanked us profusely for giving him space to feel anger in a group setting. And I think that it's been really moving for me personally to be witness to so much of that grief, and to be present in it, even though it's total strangers.
And that's particularly vital. I mean, the role of this film, perhaps on many levels, coming out now, it's particularly prescient, and perhaps that's also why people are responding so much. Lucy, I'd just like to bring you in, and then I'd like to also bring the filmmakers into that point. I mean, you've said that the pandemic has brought death center stage. And as I said before, I feel like films like this do, I think we all need a space to feel all these complicated things about what we may have lost or who we may have lost, particularly this year. So can you just talk a little bit about your work, particularly now, and then I'd like to situate it back to the film, to the filmmakers.
I think it's hugely relevant now. I mean, you guys couldn't have known that this was going to happen. But, you know, in the UK, we've had over 125,000 people who've died of COVID-19 in the last 12 months. So that means that the number of people who've experienced a sudden and unexpected bereavement has actually quadrupled in the last year compared to the previous year. And, you know, those when you've gone through a sudden and unexpected loss of that kind, the impact in terms of, you know, potentially having poor, what they call poor bereavement outcomes down the line, so PTSD, depression, anxiety, suicidal ideation, that kind of thing, it's much higher when you've gone through a sudden and unexpected death, especially in the context of a global pandemic. You know, we don't know yet what the mental health kind of implications of that are going to be, but they'll be going to become clear over the next, you know, couple of years. And so I think a film like this is really important because, you know, as you just said, Norah, you're portraying grief in an authentic way, which shows people that they're not alone. It shows people, gives people a vocabulary and a way of understanding their experiences. And it also allows them to imagine and tap into other possibilities in terms of what they might be going through. You know, that art always provides that, doesn't it? And it allows people to think more broadly than their own experience. And that's really important when people haven't been bereaved, because I think a lot of people, they just don't really understand what grief is, and they're so afraid of saying the wrong thing to somebody that they may not say anything at all, which makes people feel even more isolated. And that was one of the reasons why we came up with the idea of the Good Grief Festival. It's really to give people time and space to reflect on and learn about grief. And we do that through kind of integrating the arts along with kind of science as well. So just a brief plug to encourage people to go and look at the website. You know, all the events are free to attend. So,
Yeah, I mean, it's I'm really interested to hear you speak about that. I think I've been thinking so much about the isolation and the people being alone, not being able to be present at the moment of death, even though you know it's happening, and the not being able to have a funeral, not being able to give space. And I know in my own personal life the importance of taking that time, making, carving out space, saying nothing else is going to happen. And I think in a small way, when we watch a film like Mouthpiece, we are carving out some time, whether it's like, I need time to cry, I need time to just sit in and soak in it, or whatever it is. There is this like very urgent feeling of making the space and the time to feel as much as people must be feeling right now.
And through the feeling, you then also, you know, you become more empowered to talk to other people and to reach out to other people and to maybe try and guess how other someone else is feeling, and be the one who dares to say, I'm so sorry that happened to you. Is there anything I can do?
Mm-hmm. I think another element of the film that seems as prescient as grief is the mother who has had to give up her dreams and her career for her children. And that is just feels extremely timely. We're, you know, every day there's a new article screaming about how the women's movement is being rolled back 40, 50, 70 years. That is terrifying. I certainly feel that very acutely. Being a new mom, and having the realness slap me in the face over and over again of how I'm limited because I don't have the support, especially in a lockdown scenario. So the gender gap widening, and it's so very frightening and seems extremely timely. So, you know, this film was made 2 years ago and it was extremely relevant then. Now it's not that it's more relevant, it's just more people know about it, know about this burden that women have been carrying since forever. And it's interesting, Patricia, you were talking about not getting over grief and not forgetting the pain. It sounds, I don't know how relevant this is, but that's how I feel about labor. That women, it's sort of like, well, the line that we toe is like, well, we have a child now. So you have a kid. So let's just forget about that. It was only a few hours or a day or whatever. But I just, having just gone through it, that's those, just the words that I would use about that. Let's not forget about what queens women, like tanks are modeled off of women, like we can do anything. If we can do that, we can do anything. And no wonder we're suppressed and oppressed around the globe. Because so I just wanted to chime in about that, because it's just been on my mind for the last 11 months, when I just want to see more about that and more about mothers from a mother's perspective. And there's not that much about that, obviously, since most films are written and directed by men, but I'm just so hungry to see more mothers written and directed by mothers. I'm so hungry to see more of that.
I feel like the special relevance of this film to now is springing off of something both Lucy and Norah said, that the aloneness of death right now. I, had the experience with my parents. I was on the phone, but not in the room when my mother died. And I always sort of relished that I was there at the moment she passed, but I wasn't there. I was on the phone. And then with my father, who died just a couple of months before the pandemic started, I felt his last heartbeat. I heard his last big long sigh. I heard that air leave him and I saw him shrink. And it's it was, I was almost giddy with joy that I could, that I was there for that moment. It felt like such an honor and such a reality that was a blessing to be able to see someone pass from one world to the next, or from this world to, you know, our collective imagining. That is what the pandemic has taken away. And I think that that there's going to be a suffering that people had to just know that their parents were alone in a room with some healthcare worker maybe holding up an iPad going, what's your name again? Like when they're dying, untold grief, untold. I think that's a deep scar that our whole species is going to have to somehow reckon with. And it points to something that I think our whole Western culture has to work on, which is to make death part of life more. Like other cultures, you know, kids grow up seeing the person, like even in the Netherlands, that's my background at Dutch, where they're in a refrigerated coffin in the living room for a week, and you see Uncle Hank there, you know, in this refrigerated coffin. It's closed up at night, and then everyone comes by and has a cup of coffee and a cake while he's there. So to acknowledge the fact of death physically is something deep to our animal natures, I think.
We have about 5 minutes left. I wanted to just kind of bring it back again to, in terms of, I think, what the film teaches us quite significantly, again, as regards loss, it's about how the hell you carry on after a loss like this. And the film, I think, tackles that really beautifully, particularly with the dualities, like, who am I now? Who am I going to become? And it shows the messiness of that conflict, and it's a conflict. And I know that having been through it personally, I too felt the last breath of my stepfather, who I attended last year during the pandemic. And yeah, it's a profound experience. You're completely and utterly changed by it. And so, Amy Norah, I just wanted to bring it back to you in terms of the performance and the writing of that. Just again, just anything you might want to share about thoughts on that and what you were centering there in doing in creating this work in the first place.
Yeah. I mean, for me to imagine that put me right there. It's not a huge stretch to imagine it, and just imagining it, losing my mom, especially suddenly, and entering that feeling just feels very vulnerable, very, I don't know, what can you say? It's sad. It's very sad. It's very sad. So to perform it, you know, you just have to be open. You just have to remain cracked open, and to have a director who we trusted so deeply allowed that to happen.
I think in terms of what you're saying about carrying on, for me, the whole film is about that, which is allowing it to be messy. Because the carrying on's not gonna be nice, perfect bow. Now I'm, like you were saying, Lucy, you don't get over it. You're not gonna go, okay, that's done. Now I'm one person and I'm going to move through the rest of my life neatly composed. That the whole film speaks to, yes, these events put us in this cracked open space, but it's okay to stay there too. And carrying on can look like that, and carrying or living looks like that, that we're often trying, and especially I think with the internet and social media and branding and self-image becoming such a kind of, what are you? How do you narrow the view of what, you know, what's your instant reply to a tweet, and how do you have an opinion and be a certain way instead of making a lot of interior space for the mess
Beautiful. Lucy, just any final response really in terms of, and then I will hand over to Patricia because I wanted to quote something. I wanted to quote Patricia to herself. Didn't get around the female gaze, so I would like to
remember, so that'll be great.
Any response?
I think just to, yeah, just as Norah was speaking, I was thinking it's both and, isn't it? It's being able to hold both. You know, to hold the pain and the anger, or to hold the sadness and the joy, to hold who you were and who you're going to become and who you are now. And maybe all of those people seem very different at this time. But, you know, all of that messiness, it is about embracing it, as you said. So I think, yeah, you put it really well.
And Patricia, you said you did a wonderful takeover of our Bird's Eye View channels. And one of the quotes was, in the history of cinema, almost all female characters are male creations, which is totally true. And again, it's thoughts to this double perspective. Women have been taught by men how to be women. I mean, that's an extraordinary thought. There's a lot to say, I'm sure. We could talk about this for a whole other session. But just in terms of, you know, the significance of this being the story being told by women, the female gaze, a female cinematographer, let's just end on that part, like why that's so important.
It's there's something so delicate that tells you something is lived experience. I think Amy and Norah would agree. There's something that. Now, I, as a queer woman, I have that feeling when I watch films that are by straight people about queer experience, and I think, you're just guessing here. I know you've checked in with your friends, but you're just guessing. And it's something that feels a little bit remote. And I think that that applies just to gender in general. I think if a woman is constructing the whole thing, and this is so female from the the origins to all the on every level. So I think you're never going to find something quite as pure. And then the way that Catherine Lutz shot it was gorgeous, and Zazu Myers, production design and producers Jennifer and Shin and Christina Piovizan, and most of the investors were women as well. So it was really. And I thought the whole history of cinema is for the guys, you know, like it's by them, for them. Here's one little corner where we're just going to unapologetically have a female voice. And you're shamed for that often because it's like, you're not, for much of my life, I was trying to please the demographic that's not my own, and that you're somehow rewarded for like, and men like it too. Well, would you look at that? And I thought, let's just not be concerned about what they get or don't get. Let's speak from ourselves to other women. And lo and behold, men are actually really responding because they feel the authenticity of it. They feel, and they don't feel dissed or disregarded or loathed in it. It's just not about them, you know? And so I think it feels like a privileged view into a different experience. So I think it's deeply important that women, you know, that the mic is passed. Well, the guys have been talking for a long time and know how they feel. And
even how you started chatting today, Mia, about the record number of women nominated for the Oscars is true. But I also look at this like 7 female directors nominated ever. In 90 whatever years. It's like, not enough. It is not enough.
Something that I was very important to all of us to get into the film was the Ruth Bader Ginsburg quote, is that women will not have equality until men are involved in the raising of young children, involved in raising the next generation, I think she said, because that it has so many implications. It takes us out of the workplace at a pivotal time. It allows men to gain ground at a pivotal time. It affects the choices of employers of, you know, whether they're going to hire a woman in their 30s or a man in their 30s. If they're both equally disadvantaged and blessed by having children at a certain age, then that's going to change everything. Right. that's going to change a whole, you know, Amy, I'm sure right now we could talk endlessly about how complicated that is, right? Because men make more too. So you go, well, so we'll make less, but it'll be equal. I don't know. You know, after nursing, I do think that it's very, very important that men are involved in the raising of children. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, I had two women, so it was sort of easier to say, okay, 50-50, I don't understand anything else. But in a heterosexual context, I think it's deeply important.
Before we wrap, actually, I just wanted to bring Lucy back in, because we were also talking when we were doing a prep call, Lucy, how much the grief business, as you, I think you called it, is really female. And again, like men, bringing men into the participation of grieving and a grief culture is also really important. That speaks to Patricia's point. Can you just round out on that?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think, you know, just as the beginning of life is dominated by women working as midwives and obstetrics, it's the same at the end of life and in bereavement. You know, it's become kind of women's work to be there at the end of life and to be, you know, work in bereavement. And it's been interesting with Good Grief because, you know, we had this amazing response. We had, you know, however many thousand people who completed the evaluation after the festival, and 10% were men and the rest were women. Now, I think I think that was also a function of the fact that maybe men don't complete surveys as much. But we had the same, yeah, we had the same in our online national survey of over 700 people bereaved during the last year, and around 10% who completed it were men. I think it does reflect our society's, how our society works when it comes to death and dying and grief and bereavement. It is a gendered thing, and you know, as you just said, Patricia, there's a disadvantage in that and there's a blessing in that. I think a lot of men find it incredibly difficult to talk about their grief and difficult experiences they've had, whereas women, maybe we are able to be a bit more open and authentic. Maybe that's also to do with how we've been socialized. I don't know.
So we're right at the beginning. Like, you know, was it 1963 in France? A woman couldn't write a check. You know, we were property not long ago in the most advanced cultures. We still, we still are property in many other cultures. You know, we're at just baby steps of finding our voice and finding our power. So it's going to take time. I don't have time, so I have to rush. but yeah, I think we're making some beautiful leaps and bounds. Partly thank you to people like Mia and your enterprise. I think you're doing a very, very important work for all of us. And thank you so much for giving our film such a respectful platform. It really matters to us.
Thank you. It's such a pleasure. And that's a really beautiful place to end. Thank you, Patricia. Thank you, Amy. Thank you, Norah. Thank you, Lucy. This has been a wonderful conversation. We could have carried on forever. So please watch the film. You can go to our website, Bird's Eye View, /watch Mouthpiece. And you can find all the places you can watch it in the UK. Lucy, you can plug the Good Grief Festival. I'll be going. You've got an amazing lineup. Can't wait to
Thanks. Yeah, goodgrieffest.com, and 27th, 28th of March, and all the events are free. So, and I please tune in.
Can't wait to see what everyone does next. And yeah, thank you. Thank you to everyone for tuning in.
Goodbye. Thanks. I'll be tuning you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.